Okay, so yesterday I was starting to talk about an example of a marginal interaction, but before I get back to that, if there are any questions, please ask. So we're talking about a metal with a Fermi surface, and I was saying we're going to talk about a state with some momentum P. And I was going to divide it up into a vector k that goes to the Fermi surface and a vector L, so that p equals k plus L. And it's a little bit more obvious if I chose a less symmetric Fermi surface. Let's suppose I chose something that looked like that. So now, if I talk about a momentum here, so this is p, then what I would do is I would define my little L to be perpendicular to the Fermi surface. And this would be my vector K. So it doesn't really matter what the Fermi surface looks like. There is a way of defining a decomposition of your momentum of a given state in terms of a vector to the Fermi surface and then a vector perpendicular to the Fermi surface. It's a little less obvious with the spherical surface. And then what I wanted to do is I want to define L goes to zero is my low energy. And I want to write down an effective theory for the electrons near the Fermi surface. And so we started yesterday with the free action. And because it's not Lorentz invariant, it's much easier. And it might not even be rotationally invariant. It's much easier to write it not in terms of t and x, but in terms of t and p. I guess I'll leave off the two pi's. I'm never going to use them. And then a sum over spins. And then we had a psi s dagger of p I dt minus e of p minus EF psi S of P. And the idea here is that we want, this is just the statement, this is just the dispersion relation written out. I'm allowing for an arbitrarily complicated dispersion relation, E of P, but I'm just going to zero it at the Fermi surface. Now, we want to rewrite everything in terms of K and L. So we're going to have D3P is going to go to D2K, an integral over the Fermi surface, times DL. And then we're going to expand this dispersion relation E of P around the Fermi surface. So we're going to write that E of P. Well, if you're actually sitting on the Fermi surface, you would just get EF. That's the definition of the Fermi surface. And then you would write down an expansion like that. And you could keep going. And this is what is called the Fermi velocity. It's only a function of K, where you are on the Fermi surface. So this free Lagrangian then looks like integral dt, integral d2k, integral dl times psi dagger s of p I dt minus v Fermi dot l psi s p. And now, since we're saying that the quantity we want to scale, the thing we're saying has dimension, is L, we're going to define L to have dimension 1. That's our scaling variable. That's the thing we want to send to 0, and we want to expand things for small L. So we're calling this dimension 1. But K is not being scaled at all, that's dimension zero in the scaling scheme. Now we can ask, if this is how I'm defining dimensions, what's the consistent way of assigning dimensions to time, for example? Well, you just find what you know in here. The first thing we know is that the action has to be dimensionless, because in the path integral, it's being exponentiated. You can't exponentiate that something that has dimensions. So then we know that this has dimension one, and therefore this must have dimension one, because you're adding them. So what we immediately find is that time, well, d by d time has dimension one, and time has dimension minus one. Okay, so this is one, that's one, this is one, this is zero. This is minus one. So these cancel. This is one. And therefore, psi dagger psi must have dimension minus one. So we find then that psi is minus a half. So why did I set k dimension zeros? Because in the process of scaling down to physics near the Fermi surface, I'm setting L goes to zero, but I'm keeping K fixed. Right, so I'm changing P. I'm making a P move to the surface. I'm not making P move down to zero. That's what we normally would call low momentum in a relativistic theory. We take P down to zero, so we say P is dimension one. But here I'm doing something different. I'm scaling it to the surface. I'm not scaling it to zero. The zero momentum state is inaccessible. It's blocked. Okay, so the only thing that's interesting are the states near the surface, and low energy means get as close to the surface as you can. A low energy excitation in a metal is one where I excite an electron just a little bit above the surface, from a little bit below the surface. Okay? Yeah. Oh, so in a funny crystal, the Fermi surface is going to be complicated. This is what the Fermi surface looks like if you're talking about a neutron star with no internal structure. If you're looking at the electrons moving in a complicated crystal, the dispersion relation is very asymmetric, and the Fermi surface is going to have a weird shape. And the reason why I wanted to show it in this form here is so that you could see how we would partition P into two parts, L and K, in a way that was a little less straightforward. Any other questions? So the logic then is, okay, this is the free theory. This didn't buy us very much. This just tells us how things scale as we go towards the surface for a free theory. But now what we want to do is we want to put in an interaction and ask, is this interaction relevant, irrelevant, or marginal? And what we're going to do is we're going to put in the most general electron-electron scattering interaction. So, because we don't have a good theory for the microscopic physics here. So, for the interaction, I'm going to have an integral dt. So I'm going to have some sort of scattering process like that. That's what I want to describe. And so, first of all, there's going to be an integral over all four momenta times a total momentum conserving delta function. So I'm going to have a product from I equals 1 to 4 for my four particles of a d2ki dli, one for each particle. But then total momentum has to be conserved, so there's going to be a delta 3 of p total. And then there's going to be some operator, psi dagger S1 of P1 psi, well, make it psi S. So you create and you destroy a particle of spin s, you create and destroy a particle of spin s prime. And this is all weighted by some coupling constant, which is a function of the forward momentum. Okay, so now dimensions. So if we use this scaling dimension argument, then this is minus one. This product over four momenta has four DLs in it, so it's plus four. These four fermion fields, each one has dimension minus a half. So this is dimension minus two. And then what we're left with is the product of this delta function times this C. And if you add them up, you see that this, so far we have dimension, a net dimension of plus one. Okay, and so what we find is that the dimension of delta four of P total, sorry, delta three of P total times C, P one through P four, has dimension minus one. Now what we really want to know is what's the dimension of C. C is like our coupling constant. Just like G Fermi had dimension minus two, so it was an irrelevant interaction. The gauge couplings in this standard model have dimension zero, so they're marginal. The Higgs mass is dimension plus two, so it's relevant. We'd like to know whether this is irrelevant, marginal, or relevant. So we want to know, what is the dimension of C? But we have it in this funny product, so we have to understand what is the dimension of a delta function. If we did the usual relativistic scaling argument, which is that all momenta have dimension one, then we'd say, oh, that's easy. Delta three of P is dimension minus three. Okay? But it doesn't. It's mixed up with things that scale and things that don't scale, and so we have to understand whether the delta function scales or not. And this is not too hard to do, but it's a little tricky. So the way to think about it most easily is to say, let's fix. Let's fix. Then ask, what sort of constraints does this delta function put on, keeping in mind that L is small. In fact, let's just set L to zero. So a good sign of whether the delta function should scale or not, if I set L to zero and this delta function is finite, that it doesn't care what L is, right? And so it doesn't scale. So let's just check whether this delta function is automatically blows up when I set the L's to zero or not. So for a generic, let's work with a spherical surface here, and let's look at a generic value for K1 and K2. So suppose we have K1 lives here and K2 lives here. Then if L's are zero, the delta function implies that I really have a delta function of K3 plus K4. Now, what that means then is that since K1 plus K2, I'm sorry, minus, sorry, plus, what am I saying? So how do, let's see, I'm not saying this right, hang on a second. So let me call these negative K1 and negative K2. So K1 and K2 are pointing the other direction. I think I drew it wrong. Okay, so I want the sum of k3 plus k4 to equal the sum of these two vectors. So how can I do that? So the sum is this vector here. And you'll see that if I draw a circle on the surface of this sphere, it goes through where these two points touch. That if k3 and k4 lie on opposite sides of the circle, they will add up to the same value as minus k1 and minus k2. And there's a degeneracy, which is that I could rotate this plane where k3 and k4 are, and it would still add up to this vector. So k3 and k4 equals 4 degrees of freedom, because each is a vector on a surface. And the delta function is constraining them to lie on opposite sides of the circle. Therefore, there's 1 degree of freedom that's not constrained, which is how I oriented on that circle. And the result then is that what we find is that this delta function is constraining 3 out of the 4 degrees of freedom of k. But since it's only constraining 3 degrees of freedom of k, it's independent of L. Nothing's blowing up here. So this is 3 constraints on k. And so that means that it really doesn't care about L. The fact that L went to 0 didn't change things. And so that means that in this case, delta 3 of P total does not scale at all. And that C has scale in dimension minus 1. And so we say it's irrelevant. It's irrelevant because if I calculate a cross-section, then I'm going to get something like C squared. And I'm going to have powers of energy upstairs to get the right dimension for cross section. And so, as the energy of the excitations go to zero, as the excitations get closer to the Fermi surface, I'm going to find my cross section goes away. So these become non-interacting particles. And so even though it's a very complicated system with a lot of interaction, what we're finding is that the fact that that all these states are Pauli blocked makes the interaction very feeble. And in fact, in the end, it looks like a theory of free particles, and that's what a Landau liquid is. But the problem with this analysis is it says everything looks like a Landau liquid. I put in the most generic fermion-fermion interaction. How do we account for something like superconductivity, where the electrons actually bind up? And the answer is that I made one assumption when I drew this, which was that I assumed in this picture that K1 plus K2 was not equal to zero. I made them on a cone, not back to back. So let's go back and ask what happens to this picture when I put them back to back. So the incoming particles are hitting head on. So now what happens is that I've got K1 and K2 pointing back to back. And so what is the constraint on K3 and K4 from this delta function? If you assume it's a spherical surface, then they must also add up to zero, right? And so, I mean, even if you don't consume a spherical surface, but if it's a spherical surface and they add up to zero, they could point anywhere back to back. So now, how many degrees of freedom out of 4 degrees of freedom that are in these two vectors, how many degrees of freedom are unconstrained? 2, right? Because these vectors now, as long as they're back-to-back, can point anywhere on the surface rather than just being confined to a circle. So now you find that this delta function only constrained 2 degrees of freedom of the k's, and yet it's we know that delta 3 of p is 3 constraints. So if it's only constraining 2 k's, the remaining constraint must be an L. So that means that, so this constrains 2 k degrees of freedom. Which means that this must, in this case, look like a delta 2 of k total times a delta of L total. That's how it's behaving, because it's only constraining 2 degrees of freedom of the k's. So in fact, if you integrate over all momenta with this extra degree of freedom here, you'll find you get infinity if you really set the l's to zero. And because of that, that means that the scaling dimension of delta 3 of p total in this case of back-to-back interactions is -1, because the delta function scales inversely like the argument. And so what does that tell us about the dimension of C? It has to have dimension 0, since the product is dimension -1, and the delta function is dimension 1. So in this peculiar case of head-on scattering, this is a marginal interaction. So what we've seen then is that with marginal interactions, they're scale invariant, but quantum mechanics now becomes important. It typically will tip it one way or the other. Okay? And so this is what separates ordinary metals from superconductors, is that if the theory becomes asymptotically unfree, like QED, then in the infrared it becomes weakly interacting, and it looks like a Landau liquid. But if it looks asymptotically free, like QCD, then and the infrared gets strong, and eventually these electrons will bind up, just the way quarks bind up in mesons. But just like the mesons end up being huge compared to the Planck scale, because of the logarithmic running, the Cooper pairs are going to be huge compared to the fundamental lattice spacing, which is the cutoff in this description. So that's why Cooper pairs exist and they're so big. Now, how do you decide whether or not it is asymptotically free or not? Well, in this, yeah. I'm sorry? Yeah, okay, so there's got to be some sort of cone here over which this matters, right? And that's a good question. I think it has to do with whether the mismatch of these vectors is on this order L or order 1, okay? So when I'm down to small L, if this cone puts a constraint where one set of components of K have to almost cancel and be of order L, then I think it scales like L. And when it's farther apart, it scales like 1. There's obviously some slop there. I mean, this is a rough argument. So the way one decides whether or not it's asymptotically free is you do what you do in quantum field theory. You calculate the beta function. And if this is the leading order interaction, then at one loop you have a graph that looks like this. And this ends up giving you a term that looks like C squared times log of your renormalization scale over your, I guess it's your Fermi energy. Because it's a divergent graph, it's a log divergent graph, because it's a marginal interaction. So if you now say, that your amplitude is supposed to be mu independent, you find that you have to make C depend on mu, and whether it's asymptotically free or not has to do with the sine of this term, which, because this is linear and this is quadratic, it's going to depend on the sine of C up at the cutoff. So what you find is that if C is attractive, if you have an attractive interaction at the cutoff, it's asymptotically free. And if you have a repulsive interaction at the cutoff, it's asymptotically unfree. And then what is it that sets the sine of the coupling at the high energy? So that's different than gauge theories. I mean, gauge theories, everything depends on G squared. The sine of G doesn't mean anything. But here, the sine of C does mean something. And so the question is, how do you tell whether a metal is going to be repulsive or attractive up at the cutoff scale? And the answer is it's a competition between two things. There's the Coulomb repulsion between the electrons, and there's the phonon attraction. And in some metals, the phonon attraction wins. In some metals, the Coulomb repulsion wins. If it's Coulomb repulsion that wins, it's a lambda liquid. If it's phonon attraction, it is a superconductor. Now, one sort of nice picture of why head-on interactions makes a difference and why phonons are playing a role was offered by Weisskopf. He said what happens is this electron's traveling through the crystal, and as it travels through the crystal, it causes the lattice to distort and contract behind it because it attracts the ions through the Coulomb interaction. And then an electron comes this way and sees this channel that's made and looks positively charged because the ions are still denser there. And so it's attracted along that same channel. And this contraction of the crystal is what the phonon is. It's the vibrations of it. So the idea is that if two electrons are heading head-on, they get to use each other's channel, and they feel an interaction with each other through their distortion of the lattice. I find that sort of a useful way of thinking about why head-on interactions are more different than interactions where they just scatter. Because when they come at an angle, they're going through a part of the crystal that hasn't seen an electron recently and hasn't distorted. Any questions? So this theory of the BCS theory of superconductivity, it just had a huge effect on particle physics. Mainly because up to then, everybody had been thinking of the vacuum as simple, not having any structure to it. Just a whole bunch of harmonic oscillators with little zero-point fluctuations, that's all. And it was Nambu who said, well, let's look at this theory of superconductivity and ask whether this could happen in quantum field theory. And in particular, what he noticed is that, I mean, there's something really interesting about when you say in superconducting that you get a condensate for two electrons. That breaks the symmetry. What symmetry does that break? It breaks electron number, but since electron number is gauged, it breaks electromagnetism. So actually, that was sort of an advanced picture of the Higgs mechanism. The Higgs model is exactly a theory of superconductivity. In fact, Weinberg wrote a little article showing how you can get the London equations and all the phenomenological equations of superconductivity from the Higgs theory. But Nambu, what he was interested in is that it broke a symmetry, and he was actually more interested in the fact, he didn't process the fact that it was breaking a gauge symmetry. He was interested in whether you could use this effect to break a global symmetry. And the reason why that was interesting is because around the same time was the work of Goldstone, which showed that when you break a global symmetry, you get light degrees of freedom. And Nambu was wondering, why is it that we have all these strongly interacting particles that they were discovering at the time, but the pions were much lighter than anything else? And so he said, well, maybe the pions are sort of Goldstone bosons of something. So he wanted to find a way of breaking a symmetry. And so he said, well, maybe the vacuum of QCD, no, he didn't say that. The vacuum of the strong interactions breaks the symmetry. And that symmetry gives you Goldstone bosons. Now, this was in the early 60s, there's no theory of QCD. I think quarks are a pretty new idea. And he suggested that there could be a condensate of quarks which breaks a symmetry and gives rise to Goldstone bosons. Now, what symmetry does this operator break? chiral symmetry because it links lefts with rights. Okay, and so the Goldson bosons will be the ones associated with chiral rotations. And so he proposed that those are the pions. So that went through a bunch of work over the 60s. Probably the thing that really fascinated people in the 60s, and which was extremely confusing to them, was symmetry. Because there were exact symmetries, exact global symmetries, and there were explicitly broken global symmetries, and there were gauge symmetries, and there were anomalous symmetries, and there were spontaneously broken gauge symmetries, and you know, just trying to put it all together and understand what was going on was very confusing. It took about a decade to sort out. So we now believe this is the correct picture of QCD, that there is a condensate, that the vacuum is very non-trivial, and that these particle-antiparticle pairs flood the vacuum. And so let's try to understand what's going on there. So first let's talk about the symmetries of QCD. So if we forget about the weak interactions or the electromagnetic interactions, we just have a sum of kinetic terms over the six quarks with the covariant derivative with glue in there, and different masses for each quark. Now, and of course we have the gluon kinetic term. Now this theory, if you got rid of the masses, would have a symmetry where QI goes to, okay, so the kinetic term then breaks up into left and right. And so the theory has independent transformations on the lefts and the rights. And so if I were to set the masses to zero, then I would have Q bar left I goes to L I J, Q left J, and Q right J goes I goes to R I J, Q right J, where L and R are independent U3 matrices. So we can write U3, so this is a U3 cross U3. And this can be written as SU3 cross, SU3 left cross U1 left. Sorry, if I had six quarks, it'd be six. We call it NF. Now we can recombine the U1s so that instead of rotating just the left or just the right, we can either rotate them together, in which case it's baryon number, or in opposite directions, in which case it's axial. So we can rewrite this as U1 baryon number cross U1 axial. We cannot write SUN left cross SUN right as SUN vector times SUN axial. The reason is because if you say I've got a SUN axial, so the reason is because SUN axial is not a group. So if I have a generator, you know that in general the rule for a group is you need to have a relation like this. Let me write this, where these are the generators. And the problem is, if you say that QA is equal to a flavor generator times gamma 5, then you've got a problem, which is that this becomes TA TB, and the gamma 5 squared is 1, and that's equal to FABC TC, which is not equal to FI FABC TC gamma 5. So if I put, what I'm saying is if I put a gamma 5 here, that's equal to the same thing without the gamma 5s, because gamma 5 squared is 1. Okay, so I end up not getting the same charge back. I get the same charge without the gamma 5. Okay. Now for the U1, this side's 0, and so it works. So I can talk about a U1 axial, but I can't talk about an SU3 axial. Okay, it's just not a group. So that's why people talk about SUN left, cross SUN right, cross U1 baryon number, cross U1 axial. Is there a question about what I just did here? Now, one of the things they discovered in the 60s and 70s was that this U1 axial has a color anomaly. And since color gets strong, it completely destroys the symmetry. So this is actually not a symmetry. And it's a symmetry at the classical level, but it's not a symmetry at the quantum level. And the modern way of understanding that is when you put when you write a path integral, you have e to the I s, and s, the action, has U1 axial as a symmetry, but your integration measure in the path integral does not. When you change your variables under a symmetry transformation, you get a Jacobian. And the Jacobian is a determinant of an infinite matrix. And naively, that infinite matrix, when you take the Jacobian, gives you 1. But when you regulate it, so that you could take the Jacobian of a finite matrix and then eventually take your cutoff to infinity, you're left with something that involves the gluon fields, GG dual, and because of instantons, it's not a negligible effect. So the U1 axial is not there, and so we have this symmetry. Now, the problem is, I do have quark masses, and then the question is, so I don't have this symmetry. If the quark masses were all equal, then I wouldn't have the chiral symmetry, but I would still be left with a subgroup of the symmetry. So if you have equal masses, then there's still a symmetry where L equals R. Because this M is a unit matrix, and if I multiply by, so if I've got Q bar left M, Q right, and if this is a unit matrix, then it gets multiplied on this side by L dagger and that side by R, but if they're equal, and M is a unit matrix, then they just go through each other and annihilate. So then you still have a symmetry, and that tells you that there's a subgroup of SUN left cross SUN right, which is called SUN vector, and that would still be a symmetry of the theory. But the quark masses are not only non-zero, they're not equal. So how do we sort out what is the symmetry? You know, is there an SU6 cross SU6, or SU2 cross SU2, or just an SU3, or what is it? So if you have a mass that's breaking a symmetry, you don't know how badly it's breaking the symmetry until you have another mass to compare it with. You have to have a dimensionless number. And as we'll see, there is a mass scale that determines how big or small M is, which is related to the size of the condensate. This breaks chiral symmetry spontaneously, and so you should be comparing this scale against the explicit breaking to see whether the explicit breaking is big or small. Okay, and this is going to give us a scale on the order of a GeV. And against this scale, you find then that M top, MB, MC are heavy. There's no sense that these masses are small compared to 1 GeV. MU and MD are light. These are, from the lattice, these are about 2.5 MeV and 5 MeV. And then the MS is around 100 MeV. And since I don't really know whether this is 1 GeV or half a GeV or whatever, this is sort of light. And so when people talk about chiral symmetry, they don't talk about these quarks at all. They talk definitely about the up and down. Maybe they're talking about an SU2 chiral Lagrangian, or maybe they're going to be a little bit ambitious and try to get more predictions by assuming a bigger symmetry, an SU3 symmetry. So I'll be talking about an SU3 cross SU3 chiral Lagrangian. And we'll have to talk about how it's broken also, how the symmetry is broken. So The reason why this is a system that is amenable to effective field theory treatment is because, remember, the basic idea of an effective field theory is you need to have an energy hierarchy, and then you're using that ratio of low energy to high energy as your expansion parameter. And in general, QCD does not have many energy hierarchies, but it does here if there are Goldstone bosons, because in the limit that these quark masses go to zero, most of the resonances are still out of GV, but the pions become massless. And so there's a natural hierarchy between the pion mass and the rest of the resonances. And so that's what we're going to exploit then with this chiral Lagrangian. Now, the difference from the other theories we've talked about is this is a strongly interacting theory, and we don't know how to compute coefficients in the chiral Lagrangian. So what we're going to do is be guided completely by symmetry, and we'll write down all the operators allowed by symmetry with coefficients that have to be measured in experiment. Now, it turns out that the theory is still very predictive because there are far more experiments you can do than there are free coefficients to low orders in chiral perturbation theory. So it's a useful theory. And these theories are very useful not just for QCD. I mean, they're extremely useful for many aspects of QCD, for studying, say, weak decays of mesons, for studying the masses of mesons, for sure, but also strange things like studying Bose condensation of pions in dense matter in neutron stars. Or you can put baryons in. Baryons are very heavy, but as long as you look at processes that don't release a ton of energy, like PP bar collisions, that reduces too much energy to be useful in an effective theory. But if you look at, say, hyperon decays, where a sigma decays into a nucleon plus a pion, the energy being released is actually low, and it fits into your effective theory. So you can incorporate baryons into your chiral Lagrangian and study weak decays of baryons and electromagnetic decays. And then you can actually also talk about nucleon-nucleon interactions, such as in nuclei, and that's another whole set of complications. So there are many different applications, but then there are also lots of beyond the standard model applications, which is going to be the study subject of tomorrow's lecture, which is you can understand the physics of axions, and you can write down analogs of QCD that are high energy that break the weak interactions, like technicolor, or you can talk about composite Higgs bosons and things like that. So first thing we need is some building blocks to describe the low energy degrees of freedom. So the idea is you've got this condensate here, and it's going to choose some direction to condense in, and we're going to make an assumption, which is borne out, that to a good approximation, I'm going to write it like this. This is some scale Q times delta ij. Namely, that the three flavors of quarks, each condenses with its own flavor, and it's diagonal, and they all have the same size condensate. So this is not necessarily what happens, because they could have different size condensates, or they could condense in some strange pattern, maybe. But this is the vacuum that would seem to have the symmetries we want. Namely, it will leave invariant the vector-like SU3, which is what Gell-Mann's SU3 is. So we write it like that. Now, the point is, the whole idea of Goldstone bosons is that the vacuum isn't rigid, that there are like spin waves, there are distortions you can make in the vacuum. And the important thing is that if I do a rigid, a global rotation on these guys, if the masses were zero, okay, so let me just write this, a new vacuum, I'll take this thing and I'll multiply it by an L and an R transformation. Let me multiply this by an SU left cross SU right transformation. Let me take this thing and multiply this Q left by an L on its left, and Q bar right by an R dagger on its right. And this becomes a rotated vacuum, or a rotated state, which looks like that, because I'm multiplying the L and the R on the delta function. And this is some SU3 matrix, because if I take two SU3 matrix, eight matrices, this gives me a new SU3 matrix. And if the quark masses were zero, then saying that this is a symmetry is saying that this vacuum is a different vacuum but has the same energy as that vacuum. Okay, it's just like the picture of the Mexican hat where you can be at anywhere on the circle. Here we're on a more complicated manifold. It's parameterized by an SU3 matrix. But now, if a global SU3 rotation of the vacuum leaves the energy exactly the same, that means a very long wavelength rotation where I rotate it over a very large amount of space but not the entire space won't cost much energy. Right? And as the wavelength of my distortion of the vacuum gets longer and longer, it'll look more and more like a constant rotation. And so what that means is that these space-dependent wiggles of the vacuum are an excitation whose energy will go to zero as the wavelength becomes infinite. And that means we have a massless mode here, and that's the Goldstone boson. So the way we are going to get the Goldstone boson is we're just going to promote this to a field, which is space-dependent, space-time dependent. So we're going to say we're not going to look at the vacuum, we're going to look at atoms of the vacuum. So I'm now going to make my SU3 matrix space-time dependent. And the idea is that if the space-time dependence becomes very long wavelength, this will correspond to a zero energy excitation. So this is going to be my building block. It's not very useful as an SU3 matrix. It's nicer to write it as the exponent of something. And the conventional normalization, or the one I will use, is that you know an SU3 matrix can be written as the exponent of a sum of, for an SU3 matrix, a sum of eight things times the eight different generators. So these generators, the way I'm going to normalize them, these are Gell-Mann matrices divided by two. They have the trace convention, TATB equals a half delta AB. And then I have to have eight fields, which are my eight meson fields. And they're going to correspond to the pseudoscalar octet. And by dimension, I want this to be canonically normalized, so it's like has dimension one, and therefore there has to be a mass dimension downstairs so that the exponent is dimensionless. And this f is going to turn out to be f pi. But we don't know that yet. So this is just a way of parameterizing sigma. Now, what are the rules for making a Lagrangian out of this? Well, I want it to be invariant under the symmetry until I turn on the masses. So we're still working in the massless case, where this is an exact symmetry of QCD. So how do I write down a Lagrangian made out of the sigma field that reflects the fact that this is still an exact symmetry? So this is a distortion of the vacuum. If I rotate it, this distortion, by an SU3 cross SU3 transformation, it should still have the same energy. So what happens to sigma if I rotate this distortion? Well, it just gets multiplied like this. Now these guys are constant matrices, but this is still that space-dependent excitation. So this must be a symmetry. Of my effective theory. So Now the trick is, can we write down the most general Lagrangian consistent with the symmetry? So this is consistent with that symmetry, but it's not very interesting because sigma is a unitary matrix, so that's one or three. Okay, that's not so good. So what do we have to do? So, I mean, it should be clear that you cannot make an invariant Lagrangian out of just sigma with no derivatives. The symmetry requires sigma and sigma dagger come together, and sigma times sigma dagger is always one. So this tells you that you have to put in derivatives, and this is the Goldstone boson nature of the excitation coming in, which is that it has to have derivative interactions. So the leading operator you can write down is trace d sigma d sigma dagger. Now, we have to put something out in front of it. What do we put? So if you now expand linear order in the pion fields and say that you want them to be canonically normalized, so sigma is equal to the unit matrix plus 2i pi a ta over f plus dot, dot, dot. Then what you get here is going to be 4 over f squared d pi a d pi b trace ta tb. And this is 1/2 delta AB, and you want this equal to 1/2 d pi a d pi b d pi a d pi a. So you got to put something out in front. What you have to put is an f squared over 4, and then these cancel. So this is our theory. This is what's called a nonlinear sigma mole. Now, the cool thing about this is that this has an infinite number of interactions in it with only one free parameter, f, because I can now expand this to 4 powers of pi, 6 powers of pi, and so on. And so we immediately have if you know what f is, we have a prediction for pi-pi scattering. Now, how do we figure out what f is? Well, I could do pi-pi scattering and then measure it that way, but then I wouldn't have any prediction. So there's another way of doing it, which is the standard one. You look at weak decay of pions. Do I do pi plus or pi minus? I'll just say pi minus. So this comes from an electroweak operator that looks like this comes from the weak interactions. And you want to take a matrix element of this, that starting from a pion and going to a mu nu. But because this is not a strongly interacting current, you can factorize this. This is so this thing you just compute in QED, for, you know, just involves U and V spinners, very simple. And this one, what do? Well, the thing that you observe here is that this is a current. It's a left-handed current. it switches U's and D's. So it actually lives inside of this group SE3 left. It is one of the generators of SE3 left, or the, if I take the gamma zero and integrate it, that is one of the generators. So this is an SE3 left current, and because of its symmetry properties, I can figure out what that is in the effective theory, because I know how the symmetries are represented in the effective theory. Namely, this is how SE3 left is represented. So I can use Noether's theorem with this symmetry and compute the Noether current from this Lagrangian, and I will find that I can represent this in terms of derivatives of sigma. In particular, what I find is that the quark current maps directly onto a current made out of sigma fields. That this left, this is an SU3 left current. Theory becomes minus I F squared over 2 trace TA sigma dagger D mu sigma. And I just get that by saying this is one of the Noether currents of SU3 left. SU3 left is represented in the effective theory. I use Noether's theorem and compute it in the effective theory. So if I expand this, so what I find then is that this U bar gamma mu gamma 1 minus gamma 5 over 2D, I'm not sure about the factors of 2 here. I get it right in the book, in my notes. You find this is the square root of 2 times F times D mu pi minus plus dot, 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 where this is in higher order in pion fields, where I've just expanded this to linear order in the pion fields and stuck in the correct generators. And so what you find then when the dust settles is that this is equal to I squared root of 2 F P mu, this matrix element. And this is the definition of F pi, where F pi equals 93 MeV. So there's this miraculous link between the weak interactions and the strong interactions that comes about because the weak interactions couple to the symmetry currents of your chiral Lagrangian. So given that I now know F pi, I can take this Lagrangian now and I can calculate pi pi scattering and I can have a prediction. And Weinberg did that and got it right. It agrees well with data. Now, how do we understand what these pi fields are? We want to relate them to the particles we actually see. So what we actually see here are the k plus k zero pi plus pi zero eta k zero bar. So those are the 8 particles we see. We don't see these pi a ta type particles. So right now I've got it written in terms of that. It's not obvious what the connection is between those 8 pi fields and these 8 mesons. So it's nice to actually write this pion field as a matrix. So if we write pi matrix is pi a ta, sum on a, that's a 3x3 matrix, which is traceless, and you can figure out what that matrix is, because notice that So this graph here is telling you how the different particles transform under SU3 vector, Gell-Mann's SU3. It tells you what the hypercharge is on the vertical axis and the I3 isospin on the horizontal axis. And under a SU3 vector, where L equals R equals V, we have sigma goes to V sigma V dagger. But we can put that in the exponent. You can check by doing a Taylor expansion that when I do powers of V pi V dagger, every V dagger is going to see a V except for the ones on the end, and you'll end up getting that. So that tells us that the pion field, this pion matrix, goes to V pi V dagger. And now I can specialize my Vs to be either I3 transformations or Y transformations and see how the different components of this 3x3 matrix transform, match up those charges that I see in this matrix with the charges I have on this diagram. And when you do that, you end up with the fact that you should write pi as 1 over root 2, pi 0 over root 2 over root 6, pi plus k plus pi minus k minus minus pi 0 over root 2 plus 8 over root 6, k 0 bar, k 0, and then minus 2 eta over root 6. The hard part, of course, is getting the normalizations right. But if you remember that it's normalized such that, I talk about it in the notes. It's not very interesting, but you have to get it right to get the normalizations right in the end. But anyway, this is how they're written in the 3x3 matrix. So now in practical calculations, you're just going to take sigma and you're going to expand it maybe to first or second order, depending on what process you're looking at. You stick in these matrices, and then you can read off all the interactions. And you immediately see that if you measure one interaction, there are going to be a whole bunch of other interactions involving other mesons that are going to be related to it. So it's a very powerful predictive theory. But we still have a problem, which is that our theory had zero quark mass, and so we now want to know how do we put in the quark masses. And by assumption, the quark masses are small. They don't break chiral symmetry too badly. So we're going to do it in perturbation theory. We're going to put in powers of masses. But what controls how we put it in? Well, the trick is something you treat as what's called a spurion, which is a very archaic word, saying that we want to go back to our chiral Lagrangian and ask, what is the symmetry transformation property of the quark masses? So let me just make sure I get a. My notation, right? Right. So let's write the mass term like this. So this is what happens, this is what you have in QCD. Now notice that under SU3 left cross SU3 right, this turns into Q bar right R dagger M L Q L plus HC. So that's not invariant. It doesn't give you back the same thing. But if you treated M as a field, which simultaneously transformed like R, M, L dagger, then it would be invariant. So let's pretend for now that M is not just a set of numbers, but it's actually the expectation value of a field. And the field transforms like this. Then it must enter the effective theory, given this transformation property, it must enter the effective theory in a way that leaves the theory invariant if it transformed like this. So, so the idea then is we pretend that M does transform, like R M L dagger, and we say, let's now insert this in as many ways as possible up to a given order in M and make the theory invariant. And the leading thing you can write down is trace M sigma plus Hermitian conjugate. This doesn't have the right dimensions to be in the action. So what we're going to do is we're going to put a coefficient in front of it, which we'll have to determine. And so I'm going to write it as 1/2 f squared lambda tilde. And f is known, but lambda tilde is not, so this is still arbitrary. Now, this is analogous to saying that, say, I had a crystal with some rotational invariance, and I put in a background B field, and now the spins couple to the B field. And so I'd say, well, if the B field transforms as if it was a vector, it actually doesn't rotate, it's fixed in my laboratory. But if it did transform as a vector, then everything would be invariant, which means in the effective theory, I would have to have a sigma dot B type interaction where sigma is the spin in my crystal. So this B field acts like M, and the spins act like sigma. And so this is going to cause the vacuum to align in a certain direction. It's no longer true that all directions are equal. Now it's going to cost energy to go out of the favorable direction. And if this enters the Lagrangian with this, and this is positive, okay, then the lowest energy case is going to be, since you know the Lagrangian is minus potential, this looks like the potential energy is minus this, and so what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to maximize this trace. That's going to be the vacuum that is most favored, and that is if M is M up, M down, M strange, where these are all positive, then the maximum value for that trace is going to be when sigma is the unit matrix. That's maximum subject to the constraint that it's an SU3 matrix. So the eigenvalues, the diagonal values can't be bigger than one, so that's the maximum. So this is, so we've chosen the right basis. Sigma field's expectation value wants to be one. That means all the quarks have the equal condensate. Now, because you've chosen a favorite vacuum, now oscillations out of that vacuum are going to cost some energy. Those oscillations of the vacuum are our pion fields. So we can now expand a second order in the pion fields and read off the pion masses. The meson masses. So you now expand. And when you do that, you find that your Lagrangian gives you that m pi squared is equal to lambda tilde times mu plus md. And this is for the pi plus minus system. You get m plus minus squared is equal to lambda tilde times mu plus ms. MK0, K0 bar squared is lambda tilde MD plus MS. So far, what you see is you get basically, this is the quark content, U and D, U bar D, or U bar S, or D bar S. So you just get the sum of the two masses for the two quarks that are in there. But the thing that's interesting and bizarre is that it's the mass squared of the meson that is linear in the quark mass. That's not true for D mesons or B mesons, right? The D meson is basically the charm mass, the D meson. And the B meson is basically the B mass. So they're linearly related. But for the Goldstone bosons, it's the square of the Goldstone boson mass that goes linearly with the quark mass. And then for the Pi zero eta system, you get a matrix. So the pi zero and the eta mix, and the mixing, the off-diagonal terms, are proportional to mu minus md, which is a measure of isospin breaking. Because remember, the pi zero is part of an isotriplet. The pion is an isotriplet, and the eta is an isosinglet. But as long as you include effects that mu does not equal md, then there's some small isospin breaking, and they are allowed to mix. Now, this doesn't look very useful because it's got this unknown parameter lambda tilde. So at the moment, all I can do is measure these masses, and I mean it's got four unknown parameters: lambda tilde, mu, md, and ms. So far I can't use it, it seems. But first of all, when you if you ignore the isospin mixing, the first thing is that there's a prediction here that is that you find that 3m eta squared plus m pi squared plus 4mk squared equals 4mk squared. This is the Gell-Mann-Okubo formula. And it is satisfied experimentally to about 1%. So that's a prediction of the theory, that this must be true. And this is a prediction of SE3 that's incorporated into this Lagrangian. So that was one of Gell-Mann's great successes. But then, many years later, Weinberg did a really cool thing. Well, let me get to that in a minute, I guess. Well, what I'll tell you about is that Weinberg was able to construct ratios of sums of the masses where the lambda, when you look at ratios, the lambda tilde falls out. And you can measure the meson masses and compute these ratios, and it tells you what the ratios of the quark masses are. And so even though you cannot use this low energy phenomenology to figure out what the real quark masses are, you can figure out what their ratios are. The only thing that I want to, why I'm not doing it right now, is because there are electromagnetic corrections to this, which have to be discussed briefly. So we put in one form of SE3 cross SE3 breaking, which is the quark mass. The next one that's interesting and is electromagnetism. So you play the same game. You go back to your original theory, QCD, and you say, I'm now going to put in QED. So now D slash equals D mu minus A mu A T A for SU3. So you now have this Q, which is 2/3 minus 1/3 minus 1/3 acting on the UD and S quarks. But this isn't quite in the form you want yet, because this falls apart into two terms. Remember, the left-handed quark piece and the right-handed quark piece. So really what we should do, we should look at A mu coupling to Q bar left gamma mu P left Q left little q, plus q bar right gamma mu p right q right little q. And we're going to have that q left equals q right equals this matrix, 2/3 minus 1/3 minus 1/3. But from the point of view of treating this as a spurion, we want to separate out these two pieces. So how does Q left transform under SU3 right? It's invariant because the rights appear over here. Q left doesn't transform at all under SU3 right, so Q left doesn't have to transform under SU3 right. But under an SU3 left transformation, this picks up an L dagger on one side and an L on the other. So I'm going to need to have the following transformation properties. So in terms of the quantum numbers of SU3 left across SU3 right, this transforms like an octet under the first part of an octet, and this one transforms like part of an octet under the second group. Don't worry about that if it doesn't make sense to you. But the question is now, we would now want to put in these Qs into the low energy theory such that it would be invariant if I had those transformation properties. So the first thing you do is when you gauge then your sigma field, what you're going to write it as is d mu minus I e a mu times, well, d mu sigma minus I e a mu times, well, you want what you get has to transform the same way as sigma. You're going to have to put the q left on the left side of sigma. And Q right on the right side of sigma. And the minus sign is determined, again, really what it's coupling to is Noether currents. And you find that when you calculate the Noether currents, you get this relative minus sign. I won't. It's because the fact that sigma transforms like sigma R dagger. If it's an SU3R, there's a dagger there, which is why there's a minus sign. Or sigma goes to L sigma with no dagger, which is why there's a plus sign there. So this is the covariant derivative now when you include electromagnetism. And these Q lefts and Q rights are both going to be the same matrix. So this is really a commutator. So the parts of sigma which are along the diagonal are going to commute with Q, and they will not have any interaction with the photon. If you remember my matrix for what the pion field was, the things along the diagonal were pi 0 and eta, and it makes sense that they wouldn't interact with the photon. But the things off diagonal, which have non-trivial commutation relations, can interact. Now, I can write another operator too, though, which looks like trace q left sigma Q right sigma dagger. And it turns out you actually need this operator because if I start calculating diagrams for corrections to the pion mass, I'm going to get diagrams at one loop like this, like that. And these are in general divergent, and you need a counterterm to soak up the divergence, and this counterterm is going to be an operator that has two different Q matrices in it, and it's got to look like a chirally invariant, like it comes from a chirally invariant operator, and this is the operator that it has to come from. So this typically is going to have some alpha over 4 pi, and I talk a bit in my notes about how you determine the coefficient. So you need this operator as well. And this operator, if you now worked in MS bar and in Landau gauge, these two diagrams actually vanish, and this gives you your sole contribution to the pi plus pi zero mass difference. Because what you find is that from the quark masses, even though the U's and D's aren't the same, the pions at leading order all have mass goes like mu plus md, both the pi zero and the pi plus. So all of the pi zero and pi minus mass difference comes from the electromagnetic splitting. So you can then fit that coefficient from the pi plus pi zero mass difference. And then you can compute other things from that operator. Now, when you include the electromagnetic splittings to the masses, then you get corrections to the masses. So remember, I said that this was u plus d. I'm using that shorthand for mu plus md. Now you get a new contribution, which is alpha over 4 pi times delta. Delta comes from this operator over here. And then you get that mk plus minus squared is equal to lambda tilde u plus s plus alpha over 4 pi delta. It gets the same mass splitting, electromagnetic mass splitting. And the m squared k0, k0 bar, that does not get an electromagnetic mass splitting. And m pi 0 squared does not. And m eta squared does not. And so I'm going to ignore the isospin splitting between the pi 0 and the eta. And so you get from that 2 by 2 mass matrix I wrote down, where is it? Sorry. You get 1/3 lambda u plus d plus 4s. And so Weinberg took these formulas here and massaged them. They've got so many unknowns here, it looks hopeless that you're not going to get any information out. But what he showed was that you could compute certain combinations that would directly tell you the mass differences, the mass ratios of the quarks. So in particular, if you take mk plus squared minus mk0 squared, so that's now a pure electromagnetic take this ratio here, you find that this is equal to mu minus md over mu plus md. And if you take 3 m eta squared minus m pi 0 squared over m pi 0 squared, you get that this is 4 ms over mu plus md. And so combining these then, so these sides are things you could just look up in the particle data book, so you now know these ratios of quarks without these unknown parameters, lambda tilde or delta. Delta has to do with the unknown coefficient of that electromagnetic operator. And in the end, then, when you put this together, you get that mu over md is about equal to a half, and md over ms is about equal to a 20th. And this was really fascinating when he came up with this in the mid-70s, because no one had any idea what the masses of these quarks were. These masses are not the masses in the constituent quark model, right? Those are all about 300 MeV, but these are much, much lighter. These are called the current quark masses, and their identity is hidden because of all the glue and strong interactions. But he was able to extract very important information about the standard model parameters from this calculation. And then this is pretty much borne out by more accurate lattice calculations. Now, the last thing I'm just going to mention is, how do you do loops and renormalization in this theory? Well, again, you want to use MS-bar. That's the friend of people doing EFT. And the important thing is that when you look at loops, say you look at pi-pi scattering at one loop. When you do your expansion, you're going to find that you're going to get 1 over Fs at the vertices, because every pion field comes with a 1 over F. It's going to be a divergent graph. It's log divergent. But in MS bar scheme, you never get Fs upstairs. The only thing you know about are the masses of the particles inside. So you're going to get something that goes like, say, m pi squared over 16 pi squared. And so you see this is a small scale, the mass of the Goldstone boson over a QCD scale. And so basically everything is going to be self-consistent as long as lambda is less than or about equal to 4 pi f pi. Because if 4 pi f pi was very small, then this would be a big correction, bigger than the tree level thing you put in your Lagrangian. And so naive dimensional analysis is the estimate that why don't we set this roughly equal, and then what you've got is a theory where radiative corrections are just as important as tree level corrections. Now that would sound like a disaster, except for the fact that every time you do these loops, Here, what I've done is I've used the lowest order theory and end up with something that's suppressed by this m pi squared over lambda squared. So in fact, the operator you get from this gets is the next order higher in the chiral perturbation theory. And so the beauty of the method here is that low order operators never renormalize their level or lower. They only renormalize higher level operators. And so there's a systematic way of doing your expansion so that you don't have to include an infinite number of operators to do a calculation at a given order. So what I'm going to do next time is talk about how to use this theory to do some beyond the standard model phenomenology. The first thing is I'll talk about, I don't know which order I'll do it. So one thing that's interesting is you can ask what happens when you have an axion. Axions can be written in the high energy theory as a particle that couples to the quarks through its mass matrix. And so there's a standard way of then inserting that. Since we know how to put the mass matrix in the low energy theory, we can put the axion in the low energy theory, and we can compute its potential, and we can talk about what its mass is. Another thing we can do is, as we talked about, QCD breaks the weak interactions, albeit at a very low energy scale. When we see the longitudinal W and Z, we see Goldson bosons that got eaten. So Technicolor was the idea that we could take this chiral Lagrange and ramp it up to a higher scale and have the W and Z masses come about. So another thing we can do tomorrow is say, let's gauge the Lagrangian where we put SU2 cross U1 in here and show how the W and Z get their masses. That theory is not very viable anymore, in part because the theory tells where the Goldson bosons come from, but there is no analog of the Higgs boson in QCD. There's no zero plus resonance. It's too broad and unstable. It's like having if you tried to have a TeV Higgs in your standard model, you actually wouldn't see anything experimentally because it would fall apart so fast. It'd be very unstable. It would just be a resonance. So that's what happens in Technicolor. So another possibility then is to ask, could the Higgs boson be itself a Goldson boson, the whole Higgs doublet? And there, what you can observe is that in some ways, the kaon in the standard model looks a bit like a Higgs. It's a doublet. It's got isospin, strong isospin. So the question is, could you make it something that looks like a kaon doublet into the Higgs doublet? And so that's the composite Higgs theory, and that also uses chiral Lagrangians. So that's what I'll do tomorrow. Thank you.